What was the flood like? Where did the water come from? Where did it go? What is the evidence it left behind? How could you prove there was a worldwide flood? What is the evidence? And what do we know about this coming judgment? For the last 2,000 years, Christians have been very concerned about how the world's going to end times. And there are 6 or 7 different theories out there about the sequence of events. And I believed in what's called the pre-tribulation rapture for 40 years. Because that's what it said in the Scofield Bible, and that's what it said in the Henry Morris Defender Study Bible, and that's what Salem Kurban taught in his movies, and that's what Left Behind series taught, and so I just believed it. I wish it was true, but it's not. We'll get into that more later, okay? We're going to be here for the tribulation, not for the wrath of God. We'll cover that later. Anyway, the scoffers are ignorant of the creation, the flood, and the coming judgment. So let's talk a little bit about this creation. What was it like? Turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1. Genesis 1:1, first verse in the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heaven, singular. Heaven, if you have a King James. All other versions I'm aware of say heavens, plural. Somebody is wrong. And I enjoy showing them who they are. So, it says heaven singular. Sometimes just one little minor change can make a huge difference. Jesus told Peter, hey Peter, you catch anything? He said, Lord, we fished all night. We didn't catch anything. Jesus said, let down the nets. And Peter said, Lord, we tried all night. We didn't catch anything, but at your word, I'll let down the net. Wait, hold it. No. Peter, Jesus said, let down the nets, plural. He said, I will let down the net, singular. Anybody know what happened when he let down the net? It caught a bunch of fish and broke. He didn't carefully listen to what Jesus said to do, let down the nets. So why is it singular, heaven, in Genesis 1:1? In the beginning, so what was this creation like? I think we as Christians had better really study what God told us in his word and go very carefully. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. We covered that last night a little bit. In the beginning, that's time, which has three parts. It's past, present, future. In the beginning, God created the heaven. That's space, which also has three parts, length, width, height, a trinity. Very interesting. Space cannot exist in one dimension or two dimensions. It has to be all three. I think God's trying to teach us something about himself, you know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. One God in three parts, which I don't understand. I don't have to understand it. I have to believe it. I don't understand gravity. What pulls this down? Nobody on earth has a clue what gravity is. We know what it does. I can demonstrate it, but I can't explain it. I can't give you a jar of it and paint it red. No, I don't have to understand it. I just use it. I enjoy using it, okay? I've been using it all my life, gravity. I don't understand the Trinity. Don't claim to. I'd like to, but maybe God doesn't let me understand it because he wouldn't fit in my little 3-pound brain. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe something would explode if he tried to cram it all in there. So, okay, well then, don't do it, God. But this creation was very different. When God first created the world, according to the Bible, the people lived to be 900 years old, plus, more than 900. There's any charts left on the table out there, Theodore? I don't see Theodore here. Anyway, there were some timelines we made up of this chart showing how long they lived before the flood. You can read the dates in Genesis chapter 5. And in chapter 11, you notice it drops off to 400 years, and then down to 200, and then down to 100. And today, hardly anybody makes it to 100. Something was really different before the big flood came. What caused them to live so long? We as Christians need to have a good understanding so we can talk to the scoffers who willingly don't understand about the creation, the flood, and the coming judgment. So, God said, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. There was earth and one heaven. Now, go to Genesis chapter, oh, no, we'll get there in a minute, I'm sorry. Genesis chapter 1 and verse number 2. Oh, wrong page. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. The Spirit of God. There's God and there's the Spirit of God. In John chapter 1, verse 1, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. First one to find that if you'd stand and read it here. John 1:1. Who's got that? John 1:1. Somebody got that? Can stand and read it? You got it memorized? Go ahead. Very good. The same was in the beginning with God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Well, who's the Word? Well, it says down in verse 14, John 1:14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Well, who would that be talking about? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the Word, capital W. And John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So God created the heaven and the earth, but Jesus is the Word, and He is the one who created the heaven and the earth. I don't understand it all. I can show it to you from the Scripture, but I can't explain it to you. Acts 20:28 says, the Lord purchased the church with His own blood. How did God purchase the church with His own blood? Wasn't that Jesus died on the cross? Well, that Jesus was God Almighty. In my YouTube broadcast about a week ago on Kent Hovind Official, I went through 20 or so verses in the Bible that teach this doctrine called the Trinity. Anyway, back to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Verse 3, and God said, let there be light. Now, light is something else that nobody on planet Earth understands. I taught physical science for 15 years. Nobody knows what light is. We know what it does. We can break it up into the rainbow, and we can use it for all sorts of things, but nobody knows what it is. Can you give me a jar of it and paint it blue? Nobody knows what it is, but we use it all the time. So we don't have to understand things necessarily. I would like to, and we should try to. But if you don't understand, how can Jesus be God in the flesh? I don't know. He said He was. Okay, good enough for me. I'm going to keep studying it, but I decided years ago, I'm going to believe the Bible until it is proven wrong. I know other people that have decided they're going to doubt the Bible until it is all proven right. I think that's backwards, and I think my position is certainly going to be safer on Judgment Day. Yeah, we'll see. Anyway, verse 4. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness He called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Those who try to teach there was something before this day have multiple problems. Scripturally, the Bible says this was the first day. Jesus said the creation of Adam was the beginning. Matthew 19:4, Mark 10:6. God wrote on a rock with His own finger in Exodus 20:11 that He made everything in 6 days. So those who want to teach the days are long periods of time, or that there's something before these 6 days, like the gap theory, they have a lot of scriptures to overcome, I think. I think it's the theory is unscriptural, it's unscientific, and it's unnecessary. The earth is not millions of years old. Why are we compromising a perfectly good Bible with a dumb theory? Just leave the book alone. It'll take care of itself. Verse number 6, what I want to get to here in a minute, though. Verse number 6. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the water from the water. Well, now, wait a minute. What is a firmament? And how can it divide the water from the water? Well, some people say it must be the dirt, because the continents keep the waters away from each other. No, it's not the dirt. Look down at verse number 7. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. So this firmament is dividing the waters that are underneath the firmament from the waters that are above the firmament. Well, what's a firmament? Look down at verse 20, and it tells us. Genesis 1, verse 20. And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and fowl, that would be birds, that fly above the earth in the open firmament. Well, if the birds fly in the firmament, it's not the dirt. The birds do not fly in the dirt. The birds fly in the air, right? So the firmament is the air we're breathing. So back to Genesis 1, 6 and 7. Verse 7 says, and God made the firmament, that would be the air, and divided the waters which were under the firmament, that would probably be the oceans, the rivers, the creeks, and the lakes, from the waters which were above the firmament. Now, what is that? I think it's gone now. But at the original creation, when God first made the world, there was a layer of water or ice above the firmament. That's the only way I can understand this and interpret it. Water above the firmament. The whole earth was like a big, surrounded by like a big crystal ball. Now, the Jews have always taught this firmament was 3 fingers thick. How they know that, I don't know. That's what Josephus said about the time of Christ. Now, either God told Adam about it, or Adam came pre-programmed just knowing those things. He had to get pre-programmed. I mean, God created Adam first day. He could walk, talk, name the animals, and get married. So his computer was fully loaded, okay? He probably knew a lot of things he didn't have to learn, like how to speak. Where did he learn language and vocabulary and grammar and sentence grammar and all that stuff? So he just pre-programmed. God didn't make two babies in the garden. He made a full-grown man, a full-grown woman. And from there, they had the babies and started this thing. But the first couple had to be fully loaded computers. So maybe he just knew and passed the information on. Anyway, this canopy that used to be above the water, above the atmosphere, probably fell down at the time of the flood, and it's no longer here. I think that's one of the reasons before the big flood came in the days of Noah, the people lived to be 900. Hovind theory. Can't prove any of this. This is just what I think it was like. Today, the air we're breathing at sea level is about 14.7 pounds per square inch. The higher you get in altitude, the less pressure there is. How many have been ever up in high altitude or a tall mountain and you can hardly breathe up there? You know what I'm talking about? Okay. Just not enough air. I remember climbing Pike's Peak as a kid. I got up at the top. Where's the air up here? You know, you can't breathe. And that's only 14,000 feet. I mean, you get up 29,000 or 28,000 like Mount Everest is. Who's the guy from Nepal was here last night? Yeah. Mount Everest, you've been up, it's hard to breathe up there. Air's real thin. Now, when people that live up there in those high altitudes come down to sea level, it's like they got a turbocharger on. Man, they're getting twice the oxygen every time they breathe, and they can run and run and run. It's just, it's amazing. I believe all the air that's now stretched out, say, 60 miles, used to be compressed into about a 10-mile band around the earth, the firmament that the birds fly in. Originally, there was one heaven. You got earth and everything else. Later, God divides it up into three slices. The first heaven would be where the birds fly with a canopy of ice over the top. The second heaven would be where the stars are in the firmament. But now it's the expanded place, the firmament. You got the air, the water, the ice to protect it. And now another layer of expanded place where the stars are in Genesis 1:14. And then in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, it says God, Paul was caught up to the third heaven. There's very little in the Bible about that third heaven. The only verse I can find that deals with another canopy might be Psalm 148, where it says, "Praise him, ye waters that be above the heavens." There might still be water above the stars. Another layer of ice. Maybe the whole thing that we see as, wow, look at all these stars. Maybe that whole thing is in a little glass ball on God's dresser. And he picks up and shakes once in a while. How you doing in there, you know? We get really impressed with how big everything, and God says, oh, yeah, let's take a look at this, you know. I don't know, but I think we're going to be stunned when we get to heaven and say, wow, what a mighty God we serve. And the fact that he wants us to be his child and will forgive us and let us into his family and into his house and make us his heirs, wow. We don't deserve any of that. He says, yep, I know. God, why are you doing this? Just grace. Just the grace of God. 46 years ago, he let me into his family. I'm his child. I'm one of God's kids. And if you're not, you can be too. He'd welcome you into the family. Anyway, back to Genesis chapter 1. So God made the firmament and then divided it up into three slices later. So in Genesis 1:1, it should be heaven singular. And quite a few times from here on, it's going to be heavens plural because there are three heavens. Genesis 1:7, and God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. It's not that way anymore. Today you can take a rocket to the moon and you're not going to run through a glass shield or ice canopy. I suspect it was probably three or four fingers thick, a couple inches thick, and it was super cold ice. Because if all the air was squeezed down into tighter to the earth, everybody on earth would get double atmospheric pressure. That canopy would provide a filter for X-rays and gamma rays and beta rays from the sun. And you wouldn't age. You young folks don't understand this, but the older you get, the more things just quit working. How many know what I'm talking about? You've been there, done that, okay, right. Like, wow, where did that pain come from? I didn't have that before, you know, okay. It's coming, just relax. I don't think they had that problem before the flood. Bible says they lived over 900 years. And all ancient cultures talk about what they call the golden age. They'll say, oh yeah, man used to live to be 1,000. Why would all ancient cultures have a legend of a golden age? Because it's true. They used to live to be nearly 1,000 years old. That canopy disappeared probably during the flood for whatever reason. Fell down, melted. But or got blown apart when the fountains of the deep broke open. We'll see that in a minute. But the canopy's gone now. And right after the flood, you notice the lifespans drop off. Go to Genesis chapter 11. After the flood, Genesis chapter 11. here we go. You see, I'm giving about the story about the Tower of Babel. And they tried to build a tower to heaven. Genesis chapter 11, verse number 10. Now, these are the generations of Shem. This would be Noah's son, Shem. Shem was 100 years old and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. Who would name a kid Arphaxad? Can you imagine that kid in kindergarten? What's your name, son? Arphaxad. You know how to spell it? No. Nobody does. Anyway, and Shem lived after he begat Arphaxad 500 years and begat sons and daughters. Now, wait a minute, 500 years? His daddy Noah lived to be 950. Shem only lived to be 600. And Arphaxad lived 35 years and begat Selah. And Arphaxad lived after he begat Selah 403 years. He only lived into the 400s. You got three in a row here that live into the 400s, and then it drops off to the 200s, and then down to the 100s. Something is changing rapidly after the flood came with Noah's son Shem. To me, the logical explanation is exactly what the Bible says. There was water above the firmament. It's now gone because of this flood. Lifespans drop off radically from 900 down to eventually 100. And today, 70 or 80 is about all you're going to get. If you be real, my grandpa made it to 86, and I'm going to beat that or die trying. I promise. Now, that's a fact. So, Genesis chapter 1, verse 8, and God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. So on the second day, God created this perfect place for Adam and Eve to live. Now there's one more factor you don't find about till much later in the Bible. Go to the book of Psalms, chapter 24. Psalm chapter 24, verse number 1 and 2. Dead center in the Bible is Psalm 118, verse 8, by the way, and the middle two words of that verse are the Lord. So the Lord is the exact center of the Bible where he ought to be. Okay, who cares? Psalm chapter 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. He hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Now read that carefully. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. He hath founded it, means the foundation of the world, is upon the seas. How can the earth be founded upon the seas? This church is founded upon a foundation. How can the earth be founded upon the seas? And established it upon the floods. You mean the earth was built on top of the water? That looks like what it's saying to me. Skip up to Psalm 33. Psalm 33. Verse number 7. He gathereth the waters of the sea together as a heap. He layeth up the depth in storehouses. The sea, the depth, the oceans used to be stored inside the earth. People say, where did the water for the flood come from? It's right here. It was inside the earth, under the crust of the earth. I'm just going to pick a number and wildly guess. 10 miles down, there were huge subterranean water chambers. By the way, there's still a lot of water in the crust of the earth. They go down to the bottom of the ocean and they find thermal vents, hot water shooting up into the bottom of the ocean. Well, now think about it. If there's water shooting up into the bottom of the ocean, where does it have to be coming from? Down lower than that. It has to be inside the crust of the earth in order to be shooting up into the bottom of the ocean, doesn't it? Anybody got a different idea? I'd like to hear it. They estimate there are 10 million thermal vents down there shooting water up into the bottom of the ocean. Hot water coming out from down deeper than that. Go to Psalm 136. The Bible says in the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is established. And if there aren't two or three verses talking about a topic, don't make a major doctrine out of it. People get crazy with one doctrine, like they said Peter was the first pope. Because Jesus talked about the Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church. Well, where's the other two verses? There's always three verses on a topic. And Peter was married. Well, it doesn't actually mention Peter's wife, okay? But in Mark chapter 1, it mentions Peter's wife's mother. So a man would be a fool to have a mother-in-law without having a wife, okay? I think he'd be a fool. Anyway, so that's another rabbit. Never let him go. Psalm 136 and verse number 6. To him that stretched out the earth above the waters. God stretched out the earth above the waters. I believe before the flood came, there was a lot of water in the crust of the earth. That's what broke open when the fountains of the deep broke open in the book of Genesis. And the water for the flood came in from inside the earth coming up. That would do multiple things. Water underneath coming to the surface would let the surface sink down. So you'd get two effects. The water's coming up while the surface is sinking down, and the whole earth is completely covered in water. We'll get into that later. Okay, back to Genesis chapter 1. So, scoffers are ignorant of how God made these heavens and how the earth was in the water and out of the water. I think if we as Christians would get a good understanding of what was the world like, we could answer all the skeptics' questions. Where'd the water for the flood come from? Came from inside the earth. It only rained for 40 days, but the water kept coming up for 150 days. So it's not all coming from rain. And if you look at when the flood started, Noah got into the ark, and the Bible says the fountains of the deep broke open, and the windows of heaven were opened. Fountains of the deep broke open first. Walt Brown's book, theater out there, do we have any more of those In the Beginning books? Walt Brown, I don't see him back there. And that's a fab. If we have any more, if not, you need to order that. Walt Brown, PhD in physics, taught at the Air Force Academy for years. His book, his website is creationscience.com. He's now in Phoenix, Arizona. But his book covers a great whole 200-page section on this fountain. Where did the water come from for the flood, and what did it do? Cracks of the earth opened up. The water went shooting out. Now, he does not believe in the canopy above. I do. I'm right. He's wrong, of course. But this canopy above would have been shattered. Somebody asked me last night, Brother Hovind, what if they find water on Mars? I said, well, they might. They might find water on some of the other planets. What would that prove? That would prove there's water on them. That's it. End of story. Okay. Now, what can we theorize about that? Well, one theory would be when the fountains of the deep broke open, I mean, if there's 10 miles of rock on top of pockets of water, you talk about a squirt gun. When that thing finally does open up, it's going to come out of there like a rocket. A cubic foot of rock weighs about 180 pounds. Get 180 pounds per cubic foot and stack it up 10 miles high. And how much pressure do you have on the bottom? You can do the math. It's a lot. Like millions and millions of pounds per square inch. If the crust of the earth cracked open, and we still have the cracks today, they're called fault lines, mid-Atlantic ridge, you know, all that kind of stuff. I think that's where it cracked. The pressure would be so great, it would launch things to the moon. Launch them out of, all you got to get up is 17,000 miles an hour escape velocity, and it escapes Earth's gravity. I think stuff got launched up into space, and the planets are traveling around, and they run into it once in a while. And I think the moon got all of its craters probably in a matter of a couple of months while it's running around like bugs on your windshield. You get bugs down here in Texas, don't you, on the windshield? Oh, yeah, okay. I think the moon was running through this debris field and probably got all those craters very, very quickly, not slowly over millions of years. And I think there could have been water launched up there, and we may end up, Mars ran into some of it a couple thousand years later, and there may be some. So if there's water on Mars, that proves there's water on Mars. That's it. It doesn't prove there's life there. And it doesn't prove it didn't come from Earth. Very reasonable theory, I think we need to consider. Okay, so this creation was very, very different. Canopy of ice overhead, it'd be like a big igloo. You know, Eskimos can go into an igloo made out of snow blocks and build a fire inside their igloo, and they won't melt the roof. Why not? Because the outside is so cold, it's attracting away the heat, and you can't, like you can boil water in a paper cup. How many have ever done that before? Paper cup, fill it full of water, put it in the middle of your campfire. It'll burn the cup down to the water level and stop. Because water has to get 212 degrees to boil, and paper has to get 451 degrees to burn. So it won't burn the paper as long as there's water in there. And I don't think this pre-flood world the heat inside would be conducted to the outside through this canopy. It'd be the perfect temperature all the time. Living in a perfect world, probably suspended by the magnetic field of the Earth, because super cold ice is magnetic, or just suspended like a big inflatable building, like the Superdome or something like that. The Minnesota Vikings have a football stadium, I hear, inflatable roof. A couple inches of ice covering the whole world could be held up. Anyway, whatever was up there is gone, so it is speculation, but that's the theory that, to me, is a lot more reasonable than the idea that we all came from a rock 4.6 billion years ago, which some of them believe. Okay. Now, whatever was up there is gone, and now things are different. When Noah got off that ark, he looked at the world and said, wow, what happened? It was a mess. Everything had been destroyed. Now, the earth is 70% underwater. Only 30% of the earth is above water right now. People say, hey, Hovind, if there was a worldwide flood, where'd all the water go? I said, it's still here. It's in the oceans. They're huge. I flew from Australia to America over the Pacific. I told one of the guys in my office, I said, that Pacific Ocean is huge. He said, oh, that was just the top of it. That's quite a thought, you know. There's enough water out there right now in the oceans to completely cover the earth a mile and a half thick. Everywhere. If you just smoothed out the earth, it'd be a mile and a half of water everywhere. There's plenty of water in the oceans to cover the world. So where did the water come from? Came from inside the earth, came from the canopy above, I believe, not much. And where did it go? It collected in big pools called the oceans. At the end of the flood, it talks about, in Psalm 104, the mountains arose, the valleys sank down, and the water rushed off. Now, if you had a mile of water covering the whole central United States, and all of a sudden the Rocky Mountains lift up and that water starts to move down toward the Gulf of Mexico, you're going to get a whole lot of erosion, and you're going to fill up the delta out there by New Orleans in 20 minutes. And it's going to look like it took thousands of years at slow accumulation. No, it all happened at the flood. And I think at a place called El Paso, Texas, you know how it got that name, El Paso? Well, it's the pass through the mountains. I believe that was all holding a huge lake up there covering half of Arizona. And after the flood sometime, it got deep enough from rain or whatever, it went over the top and it carved out that groove and made the Rio Grande River probably in a couple of days. And it carved out the pass. Grand Canyon used to be a big ridge called the Kaibab Plateau. It backing up a huge lake covering half of Utah and Colorado. Sometime after the flood, maybe 100 years later, I don't know, it got too deep. And once anybody, farmers ever had a dam to hold water for his cows, knows what I'm talking about. If the water goes over the top of your dam, it's all over in a matter of seconds. Erosion is incredible. Once it finds a notch and starts cutting a groove, it not only becomes erosion with water, it starts picking up sand and rocks and gravel and debris, and it becomes like liquid sandpaper, and it'll wash the whole dam out in minutes. If you watch my video number 6 on my series, I've got pictures of probably 20 different dams where the farmer lost the lake because he didn't have a good spillway. I think Grand Canyon is a giant spillway that got washed out after the flood. In 2 Peter 3, it says, the scoffers are ignorant of the creation, the flood, and the coming judgment. If you understand, what would a flood do to the world? Well, it would make thousands of layers full of dead things. One atheist I debated said, Hovind, you're so stupid. I get that a lot, by the way. And maybe it's true, I don't know. But if ignorance is bliss, I'm having a blizzard, so it's wonderful. I'm happy. He said, don't you know birds are always found on top of the geologic column because birds evolve last? And clams are found at the bottom because clams evolve first. I said, well, sir, there's a couple other ways to look at that, you know. Maybe clams are found at the bottom because clams are already at the bottom when the flood starts, you know. That's where they live, okay? Maybe birds are found on top because birds would be the last ones to drown in a flood. Right? Flood comes along, clams clam up. And they get buried under the mud and they wake up dead and they can't even open. So maybe they're based, maybe they're sorted in this so-called geologic column based upon their habitat. They already live there. Okay? Who's going to be buried first? Well, clams. Who's buried last? Birds. Maybe they're sorted based upon their mobility. Did you know clams can't run very fast? Maybe they're sorted based upon their body density. Did you know clam shells are a little heavier than bird feathers? Maybe they're sorted based upon their intelligence. As best anybody's been able to figure out, clams are not too bright. I mean, maybe that's a factor in their sorting. We cover all that in video number 7. But it says, Peter said, the scoffers are ignorant of this flood. They don't want to admit there was a flood. What I want to get to today, though, for most of the time that Brother Philpott asked me to cover, is my switch to the post-trib rapture and why. So I'm just going to summarize some of the things about the creation and the flood, and you can get that on the blue video series out there. What was the creation like? Why did they live to be 900? Why don't we live to be 900 today? They would have been incredibly high IQ, living under double atmospheric pressure. Adam spoke every language in the world. Well, there's only one, but he's... Okay. And something was very different before that flood. And you need to understand, if you're going to talk to atheist or skeptic friends, reptiles never stop growing. It's just a biological fact. Reptiles grow all their life. I went to visit Alligator Farm in Florida, and the guy said, oh, Brother Hovind, I've seen your videos. I love your videos. I own the place here. Let me show you the backside. Let me show you what we do in the back that nobody gets to see. I said, well, sure. Took me back to give me a tour. They get the alligator eggs, and they raise them all together so they're all the same size, so there's no competition. Otherwise, the big ones are eating the little ones, you know. I said, how big do they get? He said, well, the first year, we get them out of the egg. We get them up to 5 feet long in 1 year by giving them plenty of food and no competition. Then the second year, they get to 7 feet long. Then the third year, they get to 8 feet long. They grow one more foot. Then about 6 inches a year for several years, and then it drops off to 4 inches a year. I said, how big do they get? He said, well, they never stop growing. Never stop. Look it up in any encyclopedia. Nearly all reptiles never stop growing. People stop growing. When you're 16 or 18, you're going to quit growing, at least vertically. Some go horizontally after that. But reptiles never stop growing. So before the flood, if they could live to be 900, they would get huge, like 70 feet long, like dinosaurs. So kids, you're going to be taught in school that dinosaurs lived millions of years ago. That is absolutely a lie. Dinosaurs were big lizards that lived with Adam and Eve. Noah took them on the ark. Probably babies. Just be sure to get a pink one and a blue one. That will be important later. And there's all kinds of reasons to bring babies. Okay, they're smaller, they weigh less, they eat less, you got less stuff to shovel. And after the flood's over, they're going to live longer to produce more babies, and that's why you're bringing them to begin with. Why on earth would Noah bring two giant elephants on the ark? Bring two babies. Common sense, 101. Probably brought babies of everything. And there's only about 8,000 different kinds of animals in the world today that had to go on the ark. 8 kinds, not species. 8,000 basic kinds. Bring babies, he could fit all of them on one floor of that ark easily. Plus, they were all vegetarian. Go to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 29. People say, you couldn't put the T-Rexes on the ark. They'd eat everybody. Well, read Genesis 1, verse 28. I'm sorry. And God blessed them and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And God said, behold, I've given you every herb, that's plants, bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree, yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat. What did God just tell Adam and Eve to eat? Fruit, vegetables, and seeds. Verse 30. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I've given every green herb for meat. And it was so. All the animals before the flood came were vegetarian, according to the Bible. All of them vegetarian. Noah didn't need to have cages on the ark. He had rooms on the ark. Animals would come and go as they please. Noah didn't have to go around and feed all the animals. Be like a farmer. Just go drop off a big bale of hay and the cows will find it. You could just have piles of food scattered around the ark. The animals go get it and go back to their hole wherever they want to live. All friendly, all vegetarian. Now, after the flood, this changed. Go to Genesis chapter 9. Noah's getting off the ark, and God says, hey, bud, couple of changes coming here. Genesis chapter 9 and verse number 1. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And they did. Here we are. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth. First change after the flood, animals are going to be afraid of you now. They weren't afraid before. Animals were not afraid before the flood and not afraid during the flood. After the flood, now animals are going to be afraid of you. And today they are. Verse 2. Upon every fowl of the air, and upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon the fishes of the sea, into your hand are they delivered. The deer hunters like that verse. How many of you go out there and try to shoot Bambi's daddy? Texans, okay, good. Verse 3. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you. Now God says, Noah, you can eat meat. Up until this time, nothing ate meat. And today it's perfectly fine to eat meat. And I can't wait to do some for lunch. Okay. Verse number 4. But the flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, ye shall not eat. God said, Noah, eat the meat if you want, but don't eat the blood. Later, God gave a bunch of rules to the Jews. Now, I'm not Jewish, I'm Norwegian. But God gave rules to the Jews in the time of Moses right here, about 2,500 years after the flood. You got Moses. And he said the Jews aren't supposed to eat certain things, and they had all kinds of rules they had to follow. Those rules were even lifted later. Peter saw the vision in Acts 15, about the great sheet coming down, and he saw the animals in there, rise, slay, and eat. But those dietary rules only applied during this time frame to the Jews, and now you can eat anything. But still, don't eat the blood. Acts chapter 15, that's still one of the rules. How did we get off on that? Okay, so you got the creation and the flood, and that flood, to me, explains all the geology of the world. I don't see anything that can't be explained. We'll have Q&A time. If you got something, how do you explain this? I think the Bible explains it all. Worldwide flood, completely covering the earth. Noah's in the ark for a year. Now, that doesn't mean the whole earth is covered for that year, but it means he had to stay in the boat for that year. Some parts might have only been covered for a few weeks, a few months, I don't know. If the earth's crust was broken up into plates and they're flexing up and down, you'd get the water sloshing back and forth. Just the moon tide would cause the flexing of the crust of the earth. And the earth is still broken up into plates. And some of them are still moving, and they have, you know, earthquakes and fault lines and all that stuff. Still happening. And if you live near one, you know, the building shakes and falls down. I lived right near San Andreas Fault for 3 years, and it's a little unnerving when all of a sudden everything starts to shake, start to move around. So, creation, flood, but what's coming next? The end time. We cover all that in a video series out there on the back table if you want to get that instead, rather than reinvent the wheel. So, turn, if you would, now to the book of Daniel. Dead center in the Bible is Psalms, and after that you got a couple of major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, and then Daniel, chapter 7. And brother, this is what happened to me while I was in prison. I was reading Daniel chapter 7 and said, wow, this doesn't fit what I have been taught. We'll start with Daniel chapter 2. I'm sorry. Daniel chapter 2. If you're going to study prophecy or the future or eschatology, as it's called, you really have to start with the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 2. Daniel's been taken captive away from his family, made a eunuch, look that up, and he's now in captivity, having to serve these same people that did this to him. He's one of their slaves. The king has a dream that terrifies him. Wow, what is this dream? He dreamed he saw a giant statue, a giant image. I think I've got a picture of it right there. Okay, this is just an artist's conception of what the king dreamed. The king dreamed he saw this giant statue. He woke up terrified, called his servants together. It's all in Daniel chapter 2. You can read it later. And he said, fellas, what does my dream mean? I'm scared stiff. And they said, oh, king, tell us what the dream was and we'll interpret it. He said, I forgot the dream. I want you to tell me what I dreamed and what it means. They said, oh, king, that ain't fair. Now, come on, nobody does that. You got to tell us the dream and we'll make up something, you know. He said, no, 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 you tell me what I dreamed and what it means, or I'm killing all of you. Well, Daniel's in training to be one of these guys, the wise guys for the king. He's in training, in college, whatever they had. And so they come and say, Daniel, we're going to kill all you guys. He said, well, why? Well, the king had a dream and he can't remember it, and he's going to kill everybody. Daniel said, would you give me just a minute? Let me talk to the Lord. Lord, I need some help here, like really fast. So the Lord showed Daniel the king's dream and what it means. Daniel chapter 2. Look down at verse number 14. Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom unto Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. And he said, hey, give me some time. So then verse 19. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. And Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. He changeth times and seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. Verse number 24. Therefore Daniel went in unto Arioch, whom the king had ordained, and said, hey, I know the dream. Verse 27. Then Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king hath demanded cannot the wise men, astrologers, magicians, soothsayers show unto the king. But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. The dream and the visions of thy head upon thy bed are these. King, here's what you dreamed. As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed, what should come to pass hereafter? And he that revealeth secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have. This is a good thing to do, by the way. Don't take the credit. If God does something through you, thank you, God. Okay? It's not because of any wisdom I've got, more than any living, but for their sakes that shall make known the interpretation to the king, and that thou mightest know the thoughts of thy head. Thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. The image's head was of fine gold, his breast and arms of silver, his belly and thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron, part of clay. He said, king, you saw a vision. Laser? Pointer. There we go. The head was made out of gold, the chest and arms of silver, the belly and thighs of brass, the legs of iron, the feet of iron and clay mixed. This is the first vision you have to understand the future. What on earth is about to happen, for heaven's sake? Nebuchadnezzar, in about 600 BC, saw this vision. Nebuchadnezzar lived at the time of Daniel, here's Jesus Christ on our chart, back about 600 years to the time of Daniel in Babylon, which today is Iraq. Next to them was Persia, which today is called Iran. So 600 BC, the king has this dream. He sees this great image, head of gold, etc., all the way down. He says, what does it mean? And Daniel interprets it to him. Verse number 31. Where did I leave off? 34. Sorry about that. Thou sawest till a stone was cut out without hands and smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, the gold broken to pieces together and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, and no place was found for them, and the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, and we will tell thee the interpretation before the king. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven hath he given into thine hand, and hath made thee ruler over them. Thou art this head of gold. So he says, King Nebuchadnezzar, you are the head of gold. This represents you, the first great world empire. Verse 39, and after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. So there's going to be another kingdom of silver, another kingdom of brass. Now each of these metals, gold, silver, brass, and iron, becomes less valuable as you go down, becomes stronger as you go down, becomes less conductive of electricity. There's all kinds of interesting comparisons you can get into. I cover that in my book, which is on the back table, What on Earth is About to Happen. But he tells him there are going to be five kingdoms in the world. And sure enough, we had the Babylonian Empire. Then the Persians came and conquered them in about 500 B.C. The Persians conquered the world. After them came the third empire, which was Alexander the Great. Conquered most of the known world. Does anybody know his middle name? The. Correct. Say, never mind, okay. Then there's going to be a long kingdom, the legs of iron. Now, I, for years, taught whatever other people taught me. This is probably the Roman Empire. I've changed my mind. I think it's the Ottoman Empire. About 600 years after Christ, the Muslims pretty much began conquering that part of the world. And to this day, they still run that part of the world. Iran, Iraq, Syria, etc. Watch the news, okay? This dream centers around Nebuchadnezzar's little world. This doesn't talk about the Aztec Indians or the Inca. It doesn't talk about anything going on in South America. This whole dream centers around Babylon. And the Romans never conquered Babylon. Well, they did for a few minutes and got kicked back out a couple weeks later. So this has to be, I used to teach it's the Roman Empire. I don't believe that anymore. I think it's the Ottoman Empire. They started in 600 AD, and they really weren't disbanded until World War I when they broke up the Ottoman Empire. The final kingdom is going to be feet of iron and clay mixed together. Hovind theory. You're going to see a revival. There's going to be 10 Muslim nations get together and try to conquer Israel. If you read the visions in Daniel, chapter 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, etc., it all starts to fit like, wow, these are the Muslim nations, and they hate Israel with a passion and would love to conquer them. People don't realize Israel is smaller than New Hampshire. It's a little tiny country. They got plenty of land over there. Why don't they stay where they are? Nope. They want that chunk of property. 7,000 square miles, which you could put in Texas and never find it. I drove from El Paso to Longview one time. I said, man, there's a whole lot of Texas between El Paso and Longview. A lot of Texas. I don't know how many square miles Texas is. 250,000, I think. So Israel would fit in there. Israel wouldn't even go from here to Longview. I lived in Longview 5 years. Anyway, another story. So he saw this vision of these five nations. And God was giving him the plan of history for the whole world. So you got the Ottoman Empire ruling the world for most of the last 1,400 years. They were broken up after World War I. But I think that's going to be the revived Ottoman Empire, a Muslim caliphate starting now, already going. Watch the news. They're really getting powerful. And they're really dedicated. Doesn't mean they're right, but they're definitely dedicated. Okay, they certainly worship their God with all of their heart and all of their soul and all of their mind. Now, do they have the right God is another story. But they do definitely worship their God. Seriously, you can't argue that. I wish Christians were that dedicated. Anyway, so he saw this vision of these things. Now, the next thing that's going to happen, according to the Bible, the next event, go to Daniel chapter 9, and this is where we start on what's coming, this final kingdom of iron and clay. Now, he said this, Daniel chapter 2, this final kingdom of iron and clay mixed together has 10 toes, I think, representing 10 kings going to get together. 10 kingdoms, maybe Syria, Persia, Iran, Afghanistan, I'm not sure. You know, we've sure been over there stirring up the hornet's nest for the last 20 years with our bungling military policies. I feel sorry for the poor guys that have to follow orders when some of their leaders are just absolute morons sending them over there. But anyway, praise God for the dedication. But the next thing that's going to happen, Daniel chapter 9, Daniel gets a vision. And this is where you really got to start what's going on. Daniel chapter 9, verse number 24, the end of the chapter. God said to Daniel, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. 70 weeks. Now, almost everybody agrees that this 70 weeks means 70 sevens. A week represents a group of 7 years. So 70 sevens. 70 groups of 7 years, would be 490 years. And you start this prophecy when the command is given to go rebuild Jerusalem. And just to give you a little history here, and we'll quit for lunch in a minute, but give you a little history. Jerusalem was destroyed. But the Babylonians came in there, wiped them out, destroyed the city, destroyed the temple. Nehemiah and Ezra both talk about commands to go back and rebuild the city. If you study your Bible, Ezra was told to go back and rebuild the temple. Nehemiah was told to go back and rebuild the wall. I'm not sure which one starts the prophecy, but look at Daniel chapter 9 and verse 25. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Well, if you translate the weeks into 7 years, it's going to be 49 years and a total of 483 years. 62 plus 7 is 69, times 7 is 483. When they give that command to rebuild the temple or rebuild the wall, rebuild Jerusalem, count your clock, 483 years later, it says right here, unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. You know, they gave that command to Nehemiah, go back and rebuild the wall. 483 years later, to the day Jesus was crucified, Messiah was cut off. Jesus rode into Jerusalem on the donkey and he wept over the city. He said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, if you had only known, this is the day your king is coming." And they rejected their king. Just like in the book of Exodus, they would take a lamb, investigate it for 3 days, make sure it's, you know, no spots or blemishes, and then kill the lamb, sacrifice. That was all symbolic. They brought Jesus in, examined him for 3 days, couldn't find anything wrong. Pilate 3 times said, "I find no fault in this man." And they crucified him anyway. The Passover lamb, a lot of symbolism there. Let you preachers preach on that. So Messiah was cut off. Okay, so 69 weeks are fulfilled. That leaves 1 week left, which is what brings us up to today. People call that the 70th week of Daniel, which is on the chart right here. 69 weeks started when they gave the command to rebuild the city, ended when Jesus was crucified. 69 weeks are gone. God took the Jews and said, "Oh, you don't want my king? Okay, I'm going to put you over here. I'm going to take off the natural olive branch and graft in the wild olive branch, the church, the Gentiles. I'm going to let you guys bear fruit for a while." And for the last 2,000 years, we have not done a very good job of bearing fruit for the Lord, and he's going to take us off and put the Jews back in. He is not done with the Jews. This 70th week of Daniel starts right here in verse number 20. Well, read 26 first. "And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself." Jesus wasn't killed for himself. He was killed for us. "And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. And the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he," who's the he? The prince that shall come, the Antichrist. "And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week." There's your last week, the 70th week of Daniel. He's going to confirm the covenant. What does that mean? He's going to make some kind of treaty. Antichrist makes a treaty, Daniel 9:27. Hovind theory. The Jews would love to rebuild their temple in Jerusalem. Would love to. The Muslims own the Temple Mount, 37-acre platform where their Mosque of Omar is. They want badly to rebuild that temple. I think there's going to be another war, Israel against their neighbors. Israel's going to clean house like they always do, even though they're outnumbered 100-1. Some of the things that happened for God to watch over them would boggle your mind. I think it was the 1967 war. The Muslim tanks were coming in, and this one Jewish fellow didn't have anything to fight back with, so he put his lawnmower in a big wash tub, cranked it up, and dragged it around behind the buildings, and it made a lot of noise, lawnmower running inside this huge metal tub. The Muslims all got terrified and took off running, thinking that Jews had brought some tanks in there. Had a lawnmower in a wash tub. I mean, you can read the stories of the way God just watched over them. You know, it's amazing. They are, in spite of the fact that they're pretty much pagan, they are still God's chosen people. Okay, and we should, I don't know if we should give them all of our money, but we certainly shouldn't fight against them. That's for sure. Another law. Don't get me off on politics. Okay, so Antichrist is going to make a treaty and say, look, guys, how about let's stop this war? We will give you 10 acres on this Temple Mount. Go ahead and build your temple. Or we'll sell it to you for $400 zillion, you know. It's going to be the most expensive piece of real estate ever purchased. But you watch your, mark your clock. As soon as that treaty is made, you can start the 70th week of Daniel. Now, there's several theories through history about where does the church fit into all this. Salem Kurban, Left Behind series, they teach the church is raptured out before this 70th week starts. That is called the pre-tribulation rapture. Now, on this bottom chart, this yellow stripe, oh, right there, is greatly expanded to be the yellow part up here. Okay, 7 years would be almost nothing on this bottom chart out of 6,000 years. They're going to be a treaty. Then it says, that's in my book, it's Appendix 4A, the treaty that's made. The next thing that comes is Appendix 4B, because all of this 70th week is Appendix 4, divided up into A, B, C, D, and E. Is there's going to be a great falling away. People are going to quit serving God by the millions. You're going to be amazed at how many people quit and give up. Churches are going to close their doors all over America. Nobody's going to be coming. Those that have a great debt are going to be taken over by the bank. I just think it's going to come. Jesus warned about that. There's going to be a great falling away. But the next thing for us to watch for is this treaty. Keep an eye on the news. Now, I don't know who it is, but there's going to be a treaty made that allows them to rebuild that temple on the Temple Mount. It's called the 70th week of Daniel. It's going to be 7 years long. And we get raptured out at the end of that treaty, at the end of that 7 years. In the middle of that treaty, seven-year treaty, he's going to break the treaty. Go back on his word. Go to Daniel chapter 9 and we'll quit. Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. And for the overthrowing of abominations he shall make it desolate unto the consummation. And that determinant shall be poured upon the desolate. Look at that word desolate in there twice. This is called the abomination of desolation. We'll see that again when we talk about Matthew, what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24 and Mark 13 and Luke 21 about this abomination of desolation taking place in the middle of this seven-year period, this treaty. Just lost batteries here, fella. Okay, there. Coming up in the middle. So we're going to try to cover this afternoon in slow speed and plenty of time for Q&A. What is going to happen during this period and what we should do about it? What's coming next? Wild Hovind guess of when this is going to take place, I'll give you after lunch. I think I got it figured out. I don't know. We'll see. 7 years later, Lord's coming back. If anybody's still alive, we get to be raptured out with him. So I apologize. I don't have all my PowerPoint ready for these presentations. I've been home for 92 days after 9 years of being in federal prison for the dumbest law ever. But we'll get it together eventually, and after I've done the presentation a few thousand times, we'll kind of smooth it out a little bit. But if you want some of these charts, Theodore, are there any left?
There are some up at the table.
There are some left, yeah. We had a bunch of these printed up just to kind of illustrate what the post-trib, pre-wrath doctrine is talking about. This is what the church has believed for 1,800 years. It wasn't until 1830, a 15-year-old girl in Scotland, Margaret MacDonald, had a dream. She had a fever. During the fever, she had a dream that the church gets raptured out before the tribulation. Oh, wow. And a guy named Nelson Darby went and visited her, listened to her dream and said, that's great, and developed a whole theology based upon her dream. He invented the dispensationalism that some churches teach. That was Nelson Darby. The Darby Study Bible all came from him. He was wrong. But it still circulates today, worldwide, rather. I don't know if it's a problem in your church or not, but there's a whole lot of folks teaching that. Darbyism, based on Darby Study Bible, started 1830 with a Scottish girl's dream. Okay, more teaching than preaching or evangelistic or exciting stuff, but sorry about that today. But we'll take up with Daniel chapter 9 and this 70th week and give more meat on the bones after our short break for lunch.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for telling us what's coming. Every other religion in the world, they're nervous, Father. They don't know what to expect. They see the same things we see. and don't have a way to fit it into their worldview. Lord, help these people today to get a clear picture of what's coming and to get busy and win souls to you, Father, and help each one to be a missionary to their little circle of friends. Influence somebody for your kingdom now. Please, Father, help us to do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, brother.
Amen. What a wonderful teaching time. Amen.
Yep, I think I got him on. There we go. Okay. I need an expendable kid who's about between 10 and 12 years old. Who do we have up here? Okay, come on up here, son. Now, what's your name? Sean? Sean, come on up here, Sean. All right. Ken Hovind. Good to meet you, Sean. How old are you?
Good to meet you. 11.
I was 11 for a whole year one time. Okay. I was supposed to be 12, but I was sick for 2 years when I was 3 and a half. Had to do it over. I like science. You like science? Okay. If I blow under this piece of paper, I can blow it up. But if I blow over the paper, I can lift it up. Moving air has low pressure. So the air going over the paper lifts it up. Airplane wings are curved on top, straight on the bottom. Air going over the top has to go farther and faster, so it actually sucks the airplane off the ground, which is why they don't race Volkswagens. Okay? At about 130, they lift off the ground. Not a good thing. Okay. So, I like science, and I thought I'd show you the scientific way to make a round airplane. If you take a piece of paper and you fold it over about a quarter of an inch, and then you fold it over, and then you fold it over, and then you fold it over, and fold it over, and fold it over, and fold it over. You have an airplane. The air going over this bump is going to go slightly faster, so it's going to create lift. But we're going to confuse it just a little bit by rubbing it over the side of something here. And then we're going to get a piece of monodirectional adhesive polymer bonding strip. Now, this looks like tape, but it's $4,000 a roll to the government. Okay? How many know what I'm talking about out there? Okay, good. Now, we're going to put one side barely inside the other. And here's the most important part of this whole thing, okay? The sticky side goes down. Very important. We've tried it the other way. It won't work. You can try it, but make it as round as possible. Add salivary extract to the phalanges to increase the tenacity with the cellulose fiber. And you throw it the heavy side first, and you have an airplane. You can have that, okay? Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir. I like science, but I am sure sick and tired of them using science to teach this stupid evolution religion. I think science ought to glorify God. He's the one that created everything. I mean, he ought to get the credit for it. So if you want to get our videos on the back table, see Theodore out there, and you're welcome to make all the copies you want and give them out to your friends. Just don't change them and don't sell them, okay? But please, one guy in... is Jeff here that's made 41,000 copies of my tapes and given out? Is Jeff here? He has a Spanish ministry someplace around Dallas here. Last I heard, he was at 41,000 copies giving them out. So try to break that record, please. I don't know how this... we're trying to win a war, not build a castle. That's my philosophy on everything. I need the ushers, if you would, please. Come on up here. And pass these out, one to each family. And if there's enough, then give out, you know, two or three to a family. You guys divvy them up how you want. But at least one from each family. Hold your hand up. Give him some there, brother. There, you can take half his stack there. I wonder if you start at the back. And all right. On that chart, there are three columns of verses. I'd like you to... I need one here too, brother. I forgot to keep one from... No, never mind. I got it in my book. Okay. Before we get to that chart, though, I'd like someone to find this verse and stand and read it if you have your Bible. James chapter 1 and verse number 5. Thank you, sir. James 1, 5. Who's got that verse? Can stand and read it. Nobody?
If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth
If any of you lack wisdom, thank you, sir, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. That word upbraideth means when you scold somebody for asking. Some parents do this with their kids and really discourage their kids. When the kid asks them a question, the parents will respond with, "That's a stupid question." You're just asking them to never ask you anything else, okay? Never upbraid your children. Even if it is a stupid question, don't let them know that you know it's a stupid question, okay? Find a way to say, "Wow, well, let me help you, son. I've only explained this to you 84 times. Let's try 85, you know?" Don't do that. So if you lack wisdom, you ask God. While I was in prison for 9 years over the dumbest law in the history of humanity, structuring, which we're still working on, I still think it ought to be overturned and Congress ought to repeal it and make it retroactive and pay me a bunch of money. But meanwhile, I'll just keep preaching. So you can study all that. Jesus' disciples came and they asked him a question. I want you to look at the top of the first column. This is from Matthew 24, verse number 2. And Jesus said unto them, "See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down." Verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, "Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" How many of you would like to know when the end of the world is coming? I think everybody would like to know. What on earth is about to happen? What's coming? And what do we do about it? So the disciples asked him, "Hey, Lord, when are you coming and what's the sign?" Go ahead and give out the rest of them. I don't need any back. If you did not get one and want one, they're all handed out? You did not get one? Okay. Hold your hand up if you'd like one. We got to take the whole stack with you, brother. They're no good to me after today, so pass them all out. If you did not get one and want one. So they asked him, "Lord, what's the sign? Or when are you coming, and what's the sign?" Now look at the next column in the book of Mark, chapter 13, verse 4. "Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled?" Okay, Luke 21. "And they asked him, saying, Master, but when shall these things be, and what sign will there be when these things shall come to pass?" These are called parallel passages, all three teaching basically the same thing with slightly different details. It's kind of like three witnesses to a crime and they all give their details and they put it all together to get the whole story, okay? Matthew, Mark, and Luke each give slightly different things in there. So the disciples asked him plainly, "Lord, when are you coming and what's the sign that we look for?" And he talks to them in the next 20 verses or so. Skip down in the Matthew column to verse number 29, the first one in the orange. "Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." Was pretty clear. They asked him, "Lord, when are you coming and what's the sign?" He said, "Well, guys, I'm coming after the tribulation when the sun and the moon go dark." Look at the Mark column, starting in verse 24, Mark 13, 24. "But in those days, after that tribulation, the sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars of heaven shall fall, and the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and then shall he send his angels and shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of the earth to the uttermost part of heaven." Go to the Luke column, Luke 25. "And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Now, there's a movie series, very popular movie series, Left Behind, where they're riding along and all of a sudden people just disappear and leave their clothes behind. And it's a, how many seen that movie? You know what I'm talking about, okay? Like it's a secret coming. I think the Bible indicates when Jesus comes back, everybody's going to see it. It's not going to be a secret. Turn to the book of Acts, chapter 1. Jesus died on the cross, rose from the dead, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. And he's about to go back to heaven. And the disciples are standing there watching him as he's going up to heaven. Acts chapter 1 and verse number 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? These disciples still thought Jesus came to set up the kingdom. Not yet, guys. It's got about 2,000 years. Then I'm coming. Verse number 7. And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while he looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which said unto them, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Guys, you saw him go in a cloud. He's coming back in a cloud. Pretty clear, right? Now, when is he coming? He said he's coming after the tribulation, which we'll talk about in a minute. But tribulation time. There are some things you don't want to get confused. If you're going to study eschatology or the study of the future, what on earth is about to happen, you cannot confuse tribulation and wrath. Tribulation is what the world does to us. Jesus said we're going to have that. Okay? John chapter 16, In the world ye shall have tribulation. And Christians have had it for the last 2,000 years, and it's coming to America. It's here in some spots, okay? Why did they quiet down that Oregon shooting so fast? The guy was going around. Are you a Christian? Yes. Bam. You a Christian? No. Okay. Shoot him in the leg. Why would they want to quiet something like that down? Huh? Now, this page is a copy of one of the pages of actually a chart that has 12 columns of verses side by side. Has all the details and verses to look up. But the thing I want you to see, oh, is the PowerPoint up and at them there, guys? Yeah. And let me see. I've divided this chart up by, had Theodore copy the first part of the yellow, and then the 70th week of Daniel, where we left off. Then the second half of the yellow period, called the Great Tribulation. On your part, it'll be 4D, like David. It ends with 4E. So I took that seven-year period and divided it into five parts. The beginning, the first three and a half, the middle, the second three and a half, and the ending. What happens during those five parts, 4A, B, C, D, E? Each of those is an entire appendix in the book. And I'm so sorry we didn't get it in time, but it's coming in probably Friday when we get home, and we'll mail them out to you if you want to order one. Then it goes into, after this seven-year period, we go into a time of wrath, when God's wrath falls on the world. This is a blow up of this part right here, where the Christians are caught up out of here. The disciples asked him, Lord, when are you coming and what's the sign? He said, guys, I'm coming after the tribulation when the sun and the moon go dark. Couldn't be more clear. So the thing to watch for is the sun and the moon going dark. Now all of the verses about the sun and the moon going dark are right here. You can't read them from there. And I don't think you're on that chart. But if you have a Bible, let me show you some of them. Go to the book of Isaiah, chapter 13. Isaiah chapter 13 is the first mention of the sun and the moon going dark. Isaiah chapter 13 and verse number 10. Isaiah 13. I apologize for the cough. I've had it, especially since coming out of county jail, 12 months with very little sunlight and no fruit. So I'm thinking it did something to me. But the doctor said it's going to feel better when it quits hurting, so that's good. Isaiah chapter 13 and verse number 10. For the stars of heaven and the constellations thereof shall not give their light. The sun shall be darkened in his going forth, and the moon shall not cause her light to shine. Well, that's a strange event. I think pretty near everybody's going to see that or notice that. I mean, if the sun quit shining and the moon went dark, I think. You know, Hollywood, when they want to introduce some special person, you know, they have all the special effects and the things blow up and the sparks and the lights flash all over the screen and some guy comes out with a motorcycle and does flips in the air. They're trying to get everybody to stop what they're doing and look at this guy coming on stage. Right? The grand entrance. Here comes George. Whoa, wow. Yay, George. Okay. What's about to happen here, the sun and the moon going dark, this is the beginning of an introduction for the greatest grand entrance ever in the history of humanity. This is the King of Kings coming back in glory and power. And he's going to rule and reign the world. Now, but he comes back when the sun and the moon go dark. The next reference, there's a couple of minor references in Ezekiel, etc. But go to the book of Joel, one of the minor prophets near the end of the Old Testament. Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel. Only three chapters, easy to miss. Little tiny book of Joel. Joel chapter 2 is another mention of the sun and the moon going dark. This is what really got my attention while I was reading my Bible in prison for all those years, thinking, this is the key. The disciples asked him, when are you coming and what's the sign? And he told them, if you lack wisdom, ask of God, he'll tell you. And by the way, if you need wisdom in some decision in your life, ask him. And you'll probably find he already told us in the Word someplace. Usually most of the answers are here, or there's a story about what to do and it'll be in here. Okay, but in the book of Joel, and all of these are in the book in much more detail here, in the book of Joel chapter 2 verse number 1, we'll start with verse 1. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh. Oh, wait. What's this day of the Lord? The day of the Lord is mentioned probably 200 times in the Bible. The day of the Lord is a 1,000-year period at the end of history. The day of the Lord. It has two parts to it. It has a time of wrath and a time of blessing. When you read the verses about the day of the Lord, and from here on, from Joel, or actually from Isaiah to the end of Malachi, there are 200 references to the day of the Lord. I was guilty for years of confusing the day of the Lord, which is 1,000 years long, with the day of Christ, which is the rapture. The day of Christ is mentioned 7 times. The day of the Lord is mentioned several hundred times. So if you're going to study your Bible, be very careful with the terms. Get a King James or you're really going to get messed up on this topic and others too. But the day of Christ is the rapture. We'll cover that in a minute. And the day of the Lord is the 1,000-year period. Not the same. Okay? Joel chapter 2 and verse 3. 2. A day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong, there hath not been ever the like, neither shall there be any more after it, even to the stars of many generations. I happen to believe God is probably working on a 7,000-year calendar. Just like we had the 6 days of work and the day of rest, there's going to be 6,000 years of human history and a 1,000-year day of the Lord. It sure looks like it's going to end that way. If the creation of Adam was about 4,000 B.C., which is roughly what the Bible dates add up to. And I don't have any more of the charts in English. We have them in Spanish. But before the flood came, they lived to be 900 years old. After the flood, lifespans drop off right away to 400, 200, 100. Something happened. And we talked a little bit about that this morning. What happened? Well, canopy was gone. Topsoil was gone. Earth was totally rearranged now by that flood. They're getting sunlight indirectly and UV light, etc., because their protective canopy is gone. Lower air pressure. Lots of things probably contributed to diminish lifespans quickly. Okay. But the day of the Lord is this thousand-year period, and it comes. Oh, I'll show you when it comes. It's right here. Joel chapter 2 and verse number 10. The earth shall quake before them, the heaven shall tremble, and the sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great. He is strong and executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide it? Joel chapter 2 and verse 30. And I will show wonders in heaven and in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillar of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood. What's the next word? Before the great and terrible day of the Lord. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's a good clue. How many have ever done Sudoku puzzles before? You know, you got to get this one here before you can get this one here, before you can get this one, before you can get this one, right? You got to get... This is like a big Sudoku puzzle. Here we got the clues. Jesus' disciples asked him plainly, Lord, when are you coming and what's the sign? And he said in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, after the tribulation, the sun and the moon go dark and I'm coming. Joel said, the sun and the moon go dark before the great and terrible day of the Lord. Well, like, duh, here's the sequence. Tribulation, sun and the moon go dark, day of the Lord. You can't goof that one up too bad. After the sun and the moon go dark is when the day of the Lord starts. So this sun and the moon going dark is the whole key to everything. So when does this happen? So after Joel, there are a couple more minor references, but turn to Acts chapter 2. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts chapter 2. I should have got you another one in Joel chapter 3 while we were there. I'll just read it to you here. You already turned. Joel chapter 3 and verse number 14. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. A total of 10 times in the Bible, it talks about the sun and the moon going dark. That will be something everybody will notice. Okay? Book of Acts, chapter 2. You know the story, Acts chapter 2, they're waiting in the upper room. The Holy Spirit comes down, they all speak with these other languages, and a lot of people get converted, and the church grows from 120 to 3,000, and they're all crowded into one little Honda. It says they're all in one accord, so that would have been crowded. Anyway, Acts chapter 2 and verse number 16. Because the people are saying, oh, you guys are drunk. And Peter said, no, we're not drunk. This is what Joel prophesied. Verse 16. This is that which was prophesied by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood before that great and notable day of the Lord come. So the tribulation takes place, then the sun and the moon go dark, and then the day of the Lord starts. Now the day of the Lord has two parts to it, a time of wrath and a time of blessing. It's his kingdom, but he hasn't whooped up on the enemy yet. He's still going to give him a little more time to repent. Now, I want to show you the last place in the Bible the sun and the moon go dark is mentioned. Go to the book of Revelation, chapter 6. Would you like to know when we're raptured out according to the book of Revelation? It's real simple. Revelation, chapter 6. He's talking about the seven seals that are broken on this document. He's holding this document. Has seven, probably wax seal, like they would seal things back in those days. They would, you know, roll up the paper, and then to make sure nobody messed with it, they would put a drop of wax on there and put their ring on it to make a symbol so they'd know if anybody messed with it. Only the king had the seal, you know, the ring. So there are seven seals. You can divide up the book of Revelation fairly simply. There are STV, seals, trumpets, and vials, and they're not the same. There are seven seals, seven trumpet judgments, and seven vials, which is a bowl. The bowl of God's wrath is poured out. Revelation chapter 6. In chapter 5, he's given the book, the little book, and they said, who can open the book? And chapter 6, verse 1, and when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard the voice of noise and thunder, and one of the four beasts said, come and see. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And when he opened the second seal, I heard a second beast say, come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given unto him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another therewith, and there was given unto him a great sword. And when he opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand, and heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. And see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. Now just hold on a minute. In Bible times, a penny was a day's wages. Remember the story when the guy hired the guy to go work in his vineyard, and he paid them a penny a day? The ones that worked 12 hours or 6 hours or 2 hours or 1 hour, didn't matter. He paid them a penny. A penny was a day's wages. What's an average day's wages for a common laborer today? You get them from the labor pool, say $8 an hour, so $65. Can you imagine if a bushel of wheat cost $65? What would that do to the price of bread and cereal and a whole bunch of stuff? So what's going to happen when this seal is broken? A measure of wheat is going to cost a day's wages, which is going to bring famine worldwide. There are already a whole lot of people barely hanging on, able to cover their groceries, maybe, and nothing else. Measure of wheat for a penny. Verse number 7. And when he'd opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with beasts of the earth. Verse 9. And when it opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest for a little season, until their fellow servants also, their brethren, that should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. Verse 12, here it is. And I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heavens departed as a scroll when it's rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. First time the word wrath is mentioned in the book of Revelation. After the sun and the moon go dark, the wrath of God's going to fall on the world. But we're out of here for that. We're not here for that. We're taken out. After the tribulation, sun and the moon go dark, we're taken out, then the wrath of God falls. So the first five seals we're here for. The trumpet judgments, the vial judgments mentioned later in Revelation, we're not here for that. The lost people who are not saved and who are not taken out, they're here when God's wrath falls on the world. Don't confuse tribulation and wrath. They're not the same. We're not here for the wrath. We are here for the tribulation. Jesus' disciples asked him, Lord, when are we coming? What's the sign? Hey, guys, watch for the sun and the moon to go dark. And then lift up your head. Your redemption draweth nigh. It couldn't be more simple. Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So the sun and the moon is the key. I used to teach, we're raptured out at Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. when John, the angel said to John, come up hither. And I thought, oh, that's us going up. No, that's just John going up to see the future. Revelation 6:12 is when we're raptured out. So most of the bad stuff in Revelation comes after this. But it's going to get pretty bad before that, too. There's going to be starvation, wars. I mean, read the first five seals and say, we're going to be here for that. What should I do? Well, we'll get into that later. What should we do? Now, go back to your sheet here. I want you to look at the Matthew column. At the beginning, the disciples asked him, okay, Lord, when are you coming and what's the sign? And he starts in verse number 4. And Jesus answered, by the way, when you ask, he always answers. Maybe the answer is no. He will kill you. And ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. You know, I wonder about these preachers that are always preaching, oh, something good is about to happen to you. Everything's going to be fine. Just smile, send me money, and you'll be fine. You know? I heard one of the guys on TV one time, he said, he's selling these prayer cloths or something, you know. He said, if you'll send me $20, I'll pray that God will heal you of your poverty. I didn't realize poverty was a disease, first of all. But secondly, how is me sending him $20 going to heal my poverty? It looks like it's going to heal his poverty, not mine. What is wrong with this picture here? Okay. Anyway, Jesus said, hey guys, don't be deceived. You're going to be hated. You're going to be delivered up. You're going to be killed. They're probably going to throw you in prison. Keep reading. Verse number 10. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. Did you know Christians are going to start to hate each other and betray each other? It's going to break up families. It's going to break up marriages. Watch here. Verse number 11. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. So on my chart, I have the first 3.5 years as a time of great falling away. People are going to quit serving God. It's going to be a time of... We got the Antichrist is going to make a treaty, a 7-year treaty. There's going to be a great time of falling away. Then in the middle, he's going to break the treaty. I think he's going to give them permission to build their temple. They're going to build it during that first 3.5 years. It wouldn't take long to build it, you know, 6-8 months. They've got everything ready. The Temple Institute over there is chomping at the bit to build that temple, okay? So they could put it up pretty quickly. All they got to do is get permission from the Arabs that own that Temple Mount. They're going to rebuild that temple and start worshiping again. Start offering sacrifices, which is going to be an abomination unto God since Jesus was the final sacrifice. And then this Antichrist, who made the treaty, is going to break the treaty. It says so in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. In the midst of the week, he will break the treaty. And he's going to set up an abomination of desolation, which is probably going to be sacrifice something on the altar that's not kosher. It may be like Antiochus did, sacrifice a pig on the altar. Or maybe set up an image of himself, maybe an artificial intelligence kind of robot thing, you know, and say, hey, y'all worship me. I don't know what it's going to be. But there's going to be he's going to desolate their brand new temple with what's called an abomination. Now, there are two kinds of abominations in the Bible. An abomination means it makes you sick. Sometimes God says, don't do that. It's an abomination unto you. God told the Jews, don't eat pork. It's an abomination unto you. It'll make you sick. But he said, if a woman wears a man's clothing in Deuteronomy 25, he said, that's an abomination unto me. It makes God sick. Some things are abomination to God, and some things are an abomination unto you. Just don't do it. It'll make you sick. And you can do it if you want. But that's the two different kinds of abomination. Who cares? And rabbit. There he goes. Okay. Verse number 10. And then they shall many be offended and shall betray one another and hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come. Verse 15. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet... You can write in the margin there, Daniel 9, verse 27. Stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand. This green is the middle of this seven-year period when he breaks the treaty and sets up an abomination. Look at the Mark column now. Mark chapter 13, verse 5. And Jesus answering them began to say, "Take heed, lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled. For such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in divers places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in the synagogues ye shall be beaten, and ye shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them. And the gospel must first be published among all nations." You know, I think that's exactly what God's waiting for. Has the gospel gone out to all nations? Are there any parts of the world that haven't heard yet? Maybe that's your job to go tell them. Have the folks in Nepal, our brother from Nepal, have they all heard the gospel, at least had a chance? Have the folks in Kazakhstan heard? Have the folks in Lithuania heard, and Latvia and Estonia? God is not willing that any should perish. He wants everybody saved. And he's going to leave us here while they beat us up so that they can get a testimony. You know, the Roman centurion watched Jesus die on the cross and said, "Man, this was the Son of God." And it was Jesus' suffering that caused that guy to get saved. And it was people seeing me go to prison for not doing anything wrong that's caused a lot of people to say, "Wow, I better give my heart to the Lord and get saved." No, I don't like it. I hope it doesn't happen again. But God used it, okay? And if something bad happens to you and you just patiently suffer and take it, your neighbors are going to say, "Wow, how do you do that? I need what you've got." Your suffering for the Lord might bring somebody else to salvation. Now do the math. If you have to suffer for 9 years so that somebody gets saved to spend eternity in heaven, is trading 9 years of your life of trouble and trials for 10 bazillion years of them going to heaven forever, I mean, that's a good trade, I think. God thinks it's a good trade. He'll let you suffer, maybe. He'll reward you greatly for it. By the way, those who suffer for him get a great reward. We'll talk about that in a minute. Verse number 11. "But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do ye premeditate. But whatsoever ye shall be given to you in that hour, that speak ye, for it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost. Now the brother shall betray the brother to death, and the father the son. And the children shall rise up against their parents, and shall cause them to be put to death. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And when ye shall see the abomination of desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing where it ought not, let him that readeth understand. Then let them that are in Judea flee to the mountains." Similar passage in the book of Luke. You can read that on your own. But here we have the sequence. They ask him a question. He says, "Guys, there's going to be real time of trouble. People are going to fall away. They're going to quit serving God. And then there's going to be an abomination set up in the temple." And then comes the real tribulation. You think this was bad? Wait till Satan gets control of the temple and sets up the abomination. We'll cover that after a short break. The yellow section on your chart. So hang on to that. And the other piece of paper we'll get into in a minute. But the key is the sun and the moon going dark. If you want all the references, you can come look at my chart during the break. They're all written right there, all 10 of them, the sun and the moon going dark. Or in the book, I'll lay that down here. Same thing. That is Appendix 4E in the book, if you want to take a look at that. Again, I apologize, we don't have any. We'll get them. One more thing I wanted to cover before. Oh, well, I'll think of it later when my brother straightens up. But he's a hunchback, so it might be a while. Okay. All right, thank you for your patience. A little more of a teaching than anything else here. Let's pray, and then we'll take about a 15-minute break, brother. And if you have not seen my super airplanes that fly a long ways, we're going to make those at the table for the kids out there in just a minute. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for loving us. Thank you for telling us, Lord. The disciples asked you when you're coming, and you told them. And, Lord, we just need to read your book and get ready and do what you said to do. I pray that because of this information today, lives will be changed, and Christians will be determined to do more for your kingdom. Not to run off and hide, but to win more souls while there's time. Please, Father, send revival among your church. Help us to read and to heed your word now in Jesus' name. Amen. Hang on 1 second. Brother, do you have an announcement?
It's 3. Oh, there we go. It's 3:15. We'll reconvene at 3:30.
Chapter 1. There's a critical passage that people do not distinguish carefully. Critical difference between the day of Christ and the day of the Lord. So let's talk about this day of Christ in the book. It is Appendix 4E in our book, and on your chart, the timeline I gave you there, it'll be 4E, the day of Christ. That's when the rapture takes place, when the sun and the moon go dark. It's a busy day. Sun and the moon go dark, earthquake, angels come, blow a trumpet, catch the Christians out. All takes place one day called the day of Christ. That's the day our race is over. That's the day we're looking for, and I'll show you. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul writing to the Corinthian church says something very interesting to them. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 7. Right page here, okay. Start with verse 6. Even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall confirm us, who confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the day of the Lord Jesus Christ is the day of his coming. That's the day we're confirmed unto that day. Race is over. Now go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. In this church at Corinth, which is a port city like New Orleans and a wicked city with every kind of sin you can imagine, Paul went there and started a church and got a bunch of people converted, and they had a bunch of really heathen folks who are now saved and they're trying to live for the Lord, but they still had some pretty heathen practices in their church. One of the guys in the church was living in adultery with his mother or stepmother, his father's wife. And so Paul writes to them in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and says, what is wrong with you guys? Even the heathen don't do this. Okay? He said, turn him over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 4. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, when ye are gathered together, and my spirit with the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, to deliver such a one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, here we learn a couple of things. You cannot possibly lose your salvation. You can lose your life. You can sin to the point where God kills you and takes you to heaven. You can lose that. This guy was about to lose his life, but he was not going to lose his spirit. He was still going to heaven. And we see that again in 1 John chapter 5. There's a sin unto death. A Christian can sin to where God says, that's it, you're an embarrassment to the family, come on home. That happens, okay? Almost happened to this guy. But notice, this is the day of the Lord Jesus. When? When the Spirit is saved. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. The next mention of the day of Christ or the day of the Lord Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 14. As also ye have acknowledged us in part, that we are your rejoicing, even as ye also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. The day of the Christ is the day the race is over. That's the day the Spirit is saved. That's the day we rejoice. That's the day it's done, finished, finito. Now go to Ephesians, Philippians chapter 1, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians chapter 1. Three times in the book of Philippians, the day of Christ is mentioned. Let's see what it says about him. And don't confuse that with the day of the Lord. The day of Christ is the rapture. One day. The day of the Lord is a 1,000-year period. Okay? They're not the same. Philippians chapter 1 and verse number 6. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. He started a work in you when you got saved. He's going to perform his work until the day of Christ. Race is over. We're done. Going to heaven at that point. Verse number 10. Chapter 1, verse 10. that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. That's all we got to do is make it to the day of Christ and the race is over. That's the finish line. And by the way, Indianapolis 500 does not have a prize or a trophy for the shiniest car at the end of the race. They don't have a prize for the car with the best running engine at the end of the race with the highest compression. Doesn't matter. They don't have a prize for the car with the least dents in it, do they? Just who can get across that line first? Doesn't matter. And some Christians are more worried about keeping their car shiny than they are about getting something done for God. Chapter 2, verse number 16. Philippians chapter 2, the third mention of the day of Christ. Verse 16. Holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. That's the day we rejoice. Race is over. Now go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And this will show you something very interesting if you're a Bible student. 2 Thessalonians, all the T books are together, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus, and they happen to be in alphabetical order. Who cares? Another rabbit. Okay. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, there's no question. This passage is talking about his coming. And by our gathering together unto him. Okay, that even takes away any doubt. This is the coming when he gathers us together. Verse 2. That ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us. And I think all Bible scholars agree that apparently somebody was writing letters and signing Paul's name to it. And Paul said, don't you get discouraged if you get a letter that looks like it came from us, because it didn't come from us. If you get a letter that looks like it came from us, verse number 2, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Now, if you have just about any other Bible version, including the New King James, they have changed that to say day of the Lord. How many have day of the Lord in yours? Okay. They changed day of because of this next verse. Verse number 3. Let no man deceive you by any means. For that day, what day? The day of Christ, talked about in the verse before. That day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. The day of Christ, the rapture, cannot come until there's a falling away and the man of sin is revealed. Well, the man of sin is revealed in the middle of the tribulation, when in the green part, when he sets up the abomination and the Jews finally realize, that's not Christ. He's a bad guy. But at first, they're going to think he's wonderful. He gave them a treaty. He got them to rebuild their temple. He's the greatest thing since sliced bread. But when he sets up that image and they realize, whoa, nobody sets... The Jews haven't learned much down through their history, but they have learned, don't worship idols. They finally figured that out after going into captivity a bunch of times and getting beat up. Don't worship idols. Yes, Lord. Got it. Okay. Next lesson. Okay. And when he sets up an image, possibly some kind of computerized artificial intelligence, I don't know. I know in the last 20 years, it's unbelievable what's happened with computers and microchips and stuff like that. Can you imagine what 3 or 4 more years is going to do? Could they get a robot that actually thinks and talks? I don't know. Maybe they've got it already. We'll have to wait and see on that. But during this green period, when the abomination is set up, that's when Antichrist sets up his image and says, y'all bow down and worship my image. And that's when, well, like Nebuchadnezzar set up the image of the big statue, you know, 90 feet tall, made out of gold, and said, y'all bow down and worship that. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, no, we're not doing it. But there were 10,000 young Jewish men taken captive to Israel. Only 3 didn't bow. Where were the other 9,997? Face down in the dirt, bowing to that image, weren't they? We're going to be amazed how few Christians stay true to the Lord during this coming tribulation time. Is it going to be you? Is it going to be me? I don't know. It's easy to say, yeah, I'll stand true. Wait till the bullets start flying. You'll see. Okay, so the day of Christ cannot come until there's a falling away and the man of sin is revealed. There's one more inference to the day of Christ. Now, it doesn't mention it directly. Go to 1 John, way at the end of the Bible. 1 John, not John, but 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. 1 John chapter 3, just before the book of Revelation. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 1. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth him not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. When he appears, we're going to be like him. Paul said, I can't wait to get rid of this body that causes me to sin. Romans chapter 8. I want to do right and I do wrong. Oh, who can deliver me from this wretched man that I am, you know? And if you've been a Christian for a long time, you probably understand the closer you get to the Lord, the worse you feel. Because you see every sin in your life. A person who thinks they're a pretty good Christian is probably not very close to the Lord, okay? You know, the closer you get to the mirror, the more you see the zits and the imperfections and, oh, brother, you know, right? You want to really see him, get the bright lights on in a mirror. Oh, man, what happened there, you know? Okay. When the closer you get to the Lord, the worse you're going to feel, and that's a good thing. Because then when you do get up to heaven, you're going to fall down on your face and say, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive riches and honor and power and glory. He's the only one. So the day of Christ is the day we rejoice, the day the race is over, the day we become like him. That's the rapture. That's the day of Christ. Don't confuse that with the day of the Lord, which has two distinct parts to it. The time of wrath and then the time of great blessing. Well, how long is this time of wrath? Go back to the book of Daniel, chapter 8, and there's a very interesting clue that I missed for 40 years, even though I'd read it a bunch of times. I missed it. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, chapter 8. Preacher, this is the key that made it all click together like a big Sudoku puzzle. Oh, wow. The 9 goes in the corner. Ah, got it. Solve the rest of the puzzle. Daniel, chapter 8. He's asking him, how long is the temple going to be desolate? Verse number 13. Then I heard one saint speaking unto, and another saint said unto that certain saint which spake unto him, how long shall be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression of desolation to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden underfoot? And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days. Then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. 2,300 days. Now, 7 years breaks up into two halves that are each 3.5 years or 42 months. Or 1,260 days, because they figure 360 days per year. They use what's called the prophetic year, 360 days. So that's 3.5 times 360 is 1,260. So this 7-year period is broken into two halves of 3.5 years each. Sometimes it's called 42 months. Sometimes it's called 3.5 years. Sometimes it's called time, times, and the dividing of a time in the book of Daniel. And sometimes it's called 1,260 days. But he asked this guy, how long is the temple going to be desolate? He said, 2,300 days. Well, hold it. 2,300 is more than 1,260 by 1,040 days. The time of desolation of the temple is this red arrow. It runs right past the rapture. We're caught up out of here, and I think I've got slides on that. If you got them up there, fellas. Yeah. That red arrow is the time of the temple being desolate. It is desolate for 2,300 days. It runs all the way past the rapture. Right here's the rapture. We're caught out for an extra 1,040 days. That's almost 3 years. 2 years, 10 months, 20 days for you technical folks, okay? We'll call it 3 years, round it off. So the temple is desolate for a total of nearly 6.5 years. We're here for the tribulation time. We're caught up out of here But the temple is still desolate. Satan is still in control for an extra 1,040 days, about 3 years. This is the time that, now the day of the Lord begins at the rapture. It's his. It's the day of the Lord, but he's not done cleaning house yet. And there's several parables about that where the man went away and the people said, we don't want him ruling over us. And he had to come home. It took him a while to clean house and explain to the guys in a language they could understand. That's mine. But so for the next 1,040 days or about 3 years, this is the time of great wrath when God pours out his wrath on the world. This is when the seven vial judgments and the seven trumpet judgments take place. And all kinds of bad things happen on planet Earth. And then the Lord returns. See, we are caught up together with him in the clouds. Oh, I think I've got that. I guess, let's see. No? We're really working on the PowerPoint, folks. Sorry about that. Anyway, on your chart that I gave you, if you look on that instead, at 4E, letter E, we are caught up into heaven. That's the rapture. That's the day of Christ. 4E. The sun and the moon go dark, the rapture takes place, and we go to the judgment seat of Christ. There are two judgments mentioned in the Bible. The judgment seat of Christ is only for believers. And it's not to determine if you go to heaven or hell. That's already been determined, or you wouldn't even be there. This is to determine your rewards. Are you going to get gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay, and stubble? And he's going to give you your rewards based upon why you did what you did. See, God, he judges the thoughts and intents of the heart. He not only knows what you do, he knows why you do it. And maybe you came to church one Sunday. Yay, great, wonderful. That's a good thing. You're going to get a prize for that. But why did you come? Well, because you felt like you had to, because people would think bad about you. Oh, well, then you did it for the wrong reason. Or you wanted somebody to see your new tie or whatever, okay? Or notice your new car or something, okay? Or find a boyfriend or girlfriend, okay? He will judge the motive of why you did what you did. And your reward is either going to be gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay, stubble. And then it says he's going to try everything by fire. So your wood, hay, and stubble is going to burn up. It's not going to abide the fire. Now you're still going to heaven, but you're going to lose all your rewards that you worked so hard for. Some people have worked hard all their life doing things, going to church, giving money, but they've done it all for the wrong reason. And they're going to have a giant pile of rewards and say, oh, wow, look what I did, everybody. Hey, an angel's going to say, excuse me just a minute. We got to check this out. And down drops a quarter. Here you go, sir. There's your silver. Now, all I can look at is your giant pile and say, wow, he looks like a really good guy. But God sees the reason why you do what you do. And that's all in Corinthians about the rewards being tested by fire. Now, the judgment seat of Christ is not to determine if you go to heaven. It's just to determine what rewards you get. Now, the foundation, no man can destroy. The foundation of Jesus Christ. You're building your house on that foundation, and that won't be destroyed, but your house may be totally destroyed one day. And some of the people that you think are the greatest Christians on planet Earth, you're going to be totally embarrassed when you see what really happens in their life. And some of the people we've never heard about are going to be the ones that get to stand at the front of the line. Come on up here, Grandma. Here's your pile. You've been praying for these folks for years. Folks, this is Grandma Jones. Nobody ever heard about her on earth, but she's one of my prayer warriors. Let's all stand and give Grandma Jones a hand, you know. I think Judgment Day is going to be very interesting. That's the judgment seat of Christ. It's only for believers. After the judgment seat of Christ, we go to what's called the marriage supper of the Lamb. And for that same 3 years, or 1,040 days, when the wrath of God's being poured out on earth, we're up in heaven enjoying the marriage supper of the Lamb, a 3-year wedding reception. Now, there was a king in the book of Esther who was loaded with money. He had a big party to impress his guests, and the party lasted 180 days. 6-month-long party just to show how rich he was. That's a pretty good party. Jesus' party is going to last 3 years. Okay, these kings got nothing on him. And after the marriage feast of the Lamb, then we return on a white horse. See, there's actually two parts to the second coming of Christ. The first time he only comes to the clouds and catches up the Christians. Second time he comes all the way down and touches down on the Mount of Olives. Mount of Olives splits in half, and a valley's opened up, and a river pours out from under the temple. Ezekiel talks about that. And it's going to fill in the whole Dead Sea, the whole Jordan Valley. Most people don't realize the Sea of Galilee is 600 feet below sea level. The Dead Sea is 1,300 feet below sea level. If that whole valley filled in with water, the Dead Sea would come to life, fresh water. If it got a little deeper, it would overflow and come out south of Israel at Eilat or north of Israel at Mount Carmel. Israel would have a natural Suez Canal right next to Jerusalem. We cover all that in the book. I don't have PowerPoint ready for that. But the marriage supper of the Lamb, we go, we spend 1,040 days, we actually become the bride of Christ. And I don't understand all that, okay? Maybe each person gets to be a part of the body based upon how faithful they were. Would you like to be the toenail? I'll let you use your imagination on that. Okay. So when he comes back, the second half of the second coming, or called the second advent, is when he comes back for the battle of Armageddon, and Satan is cast into the lake of fire. Satan has been causing trouble since Garden of Eden. Finally, not the lake of fire, at the battle of Armageddon, he's cast into the pit. Turn to Revelation chapter 20, near the end of the Bible, the last couple chapters. Revelation chapter 20. Verse number 1. Revelation 20 and verse 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit. How can you have a bottomless pit? I just like to think my brain once runs wild on things once in a while. Bird comes flying through and I grab it. You don't know what you got. They open your hand. Oh, that's a cool thought. You know, if you drilled a hole completely through the earth, completely all the way through, and you drop something in, it would be pulled down, go to the other side and be pulled back, and would be constantly falling back and forth through that hole with nothing to stop it. Go out, come out in Indian Ocean someplace, whatever the opposite side of Dallas is. You can look on a globe and figure it out. But drop something in, it'd go all the way down. It'd be like a yo-yo going back and forth, a bottomless pit. Never stop. Maybe that's what it is. I don't know. But Satan is cast in, verse number 2. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that he must be loosed a little season. And I saw thrones, and they that sat on them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. Beheaded. You know, there's a lot of different ways to die. Who would kill people by beheading? The souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they, that's the ones that were killed, they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power. But they shall be princes, priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up to the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things that are written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. This second judgment, the first one is the judgment seat of Christ for Christians only, right here. This one, the great white throne judgment, is where everybody appears, and everything you've ever done or said or thought is going to be revealed for the world to see. Unless you've been saved. Then the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. So when they call my name, the atheists are going to say, aha, now we get to see the real Hovind. The angel's going to say, this book's empty, Lord, clear, no sins. No sins, I knew that. Yeah, shut up, I said no sins. Praise God. Praise God for the blood of Christ. And if you don't have that on your record, you're going to be in trouble. Look at Matthew 12:34. Matthew 1, 2, 3, 4. Matthew 12:34. Matthew 12, verse 34. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. I can tell what's in your heart. It comes out your mouth. Yeah, it comes out your mouth every time. Verse 5. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Can you imagine if God played back on judgment day in front of everybody every word you have ever spoken? He will. Unless the blood of Christ has washed away your sins, okay? So if you're not a Christian here today, we are going to all get to hear every word you have ever spoken. How many of you would be embarrassed if every word you have ever spoken was played out loud for everybody to hear? Okay. How do I get that tape and erase it? Whoa. Well, that's the blood of Christ does that. Praise God for that. So this great white throne judgment is going to be an extremely interesting day. And after here, people are cast into the lake of fire. Now, that's not the same as hell. Hell is the temporary place that holds people for 6,000 years until this great white throne judgment. And then death and hell are cast into the lake of fire, which is a different place. See, hell is temporary, until a holding place until the judgment. And then you go to the lake of fire. It's sort of like when you first get arrested, you go to jail. Then you go to trial. After trial, if you're found guilty, you go to prison. Prison is for long-term holding. Jail is for temporary holding until trial. Theoretically. Okay. They moved me to a bunch of them. Whew. Anyway, so for now, if someone dies without Christ, they go to hell, which apparently is in the center of the earth. It's the only clue I can, several clues in the Bible seem to indicate that's where it is, but I wouldn't argue over it. But someday we're going to come before this great white throne judgment, and those people in hell are going to be then cast into the lake of fire, which is, and all the verses are about it right here in the Bible if you want to read that. So I was guilty of, for years, of confusing day of Christ and day of the Lord. They're not the same. I was guilty of confusing tribulation and wrath. They're not the same. We are not appointed unto wrath. We are here for the tribulation. So this timeline shows we come back down here at 5C, the middle of this, not the middle, but I broke the 1,000-year period up into five parts also, A, B, C, D. The first thing that happens in that 1,000 years is 144,000 Jews are selected to be witnesses. That's in Revelation chapter 7. Remember Revelation chapter 6, the sun and the moon go dark and we're caught up to heaven. The first thing God does is pick 144,000 Jews, and he seals them in their forehead so they cannot be hurt. During this time of wrath, they are going to be witnessing all over the world. Even when God's pouring out his wrath, he still remembers mercy and wants to get people saved. Even during that time of his wrath being poured out, he still wants to get people saved. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says, God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He wants everybody saved. Some people just simply won't do it. Okay, go to hell then. But if you want to go that bad, you're going, okay? But Jesus has done everything he can do. He died on the cross. He rose from the dead. He sends out preachers. He lets people beat him up and persecute him and throw him in prison for no reason. And he's trying to get the message to you. How many guys in the military will go risk their life to go rescue some other guy, you know? And he's a hero when he does that, and he should be, and that's wonderful. Just think about if God called you to be a missionary someplace where it's dangerous, and you go in there, you get some people saved, and they end up killing you. Like happened to the guys down at the Auca Indians down in Ecuador. They went down there in 1954. Nate Saint and those guys went to Ecuador to try to reach him with the gospel, and they killed him, all five of them. So their wives went in there and started a great ministry down there. Elizabeth Elliott was one of them. She's on the radio, Christian radio all the time. So I don't know what God has for you to do. Everybody ought to have some kind of ministry that you can do for the Lord. You better get alone and say, God, what do you want me to do? Start a left-handed, one-eyed ministry or something. I don't know. Find something, okay? People often ask me, did God call you to do this? Speak on creation and dinosaurs? I don't know. I never got a letter or a phone call. It just needs to be done, that's all. So I'll go. And maybe God's got something for you. I've often said, look, if you're not going to shoot, at least carry bullets for the guy who will shoot. And if you, okay. And if you're not going to shoot or carry bullets, maybe God's calling you to pay for the bullets. Yeah. Everybody can do something for the Lord. The worst of you could serve as professional bad examples, if nothing else, okay? What's your calling? I'm a professional bad example, okay? Find something to do for the Lord. There are many things that we ought to be doing now. We ought to be. My whole Appendix 7 of the book is, what should we do? Well, Peter gave all kinds of advice. Jesus gave all kinds of advice. Moses gave all kinds of advice. Joshua did. We've got all kinds of people's advice in here. What should we be doing? It's really pretty simple. Exactly what he always told us to do. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Get people saved. And then teach them so they can go out and get people saved. See, the Christian life is really simple. In the physical world, you get born because of what somebody else did. Okay, you have nothing to do with that. Or you get a free gift of life. Absolutely free. You have nothing to do with it. You got a gift. Now you grow because of what you do. Eat, sleep, exercise, take vitamins, whatever, okay? That growing takes a long time. And that does require your efforts. And then you get a certain age and you reproduce, you make more babies. So they can do the same thing. So you get born, you grow, and you reproduce. It's the same thing in the spiritual world. You get born again because of what Jesus did, not what you do. Then you grow because of what you do. Get to work, read your Bible, pray, get going to church, you know, confess your sins, try to keep clean. Then pretty soon you look around and say, you know, I want to tell somebody else about this. And there is no greater joy in the spiritual world than leading somebody to Jesus Christ. I got addicted just a few months after I got saved. When I led my first soul to the Lord, I said, wow, I want to do that again. It's been 46 years and I still want to do that again. It has never worn out. And if you've never led anybody to Christ, you have no clue what you're missing. And I would encourage you to go find somebody you can talk to about the Lord. If you can't get you a big one, get you a little one. I bet you could find a 10-year-old kid that would listen to you. You could explain, hey, kid, you're a sinner and you deserve to go to hell. But Jesus died for you. He wants to save you. Would you like him to save you? Yeah. Get one of the tracts on the back table out there. I gave them all out. Get a gospel track and say, now here's one. And say, hey, you can pray and ask the Lord to save you. If you don't know how to do it, just read the prayer off the back. There's no magic prayer, but that's how I led my soul, first soul to the Lord. Reading a prayer off the back of a track. I don't know what to say. Here, read this. Okay, so we read it together. But once you get addicted to winning souls, then you're fulfilling the real purpose of your existence on earth. See, if Jesus just wanted to get you saved so you could go to heaven, he would have taken you to heaven right after you got saved. He's leaving us here to get something done for the kingdom. I would be willing to bet there's 100 people within 1 mile of your house that have never heard about Jesus Christ and that need to hear about it. Within 1 mile of your house, there's a mission field. Somebody you can win to Christ. Go get them. What on earth are you doing, for heaven's sake? If you got to heaven and God piled up all your rewards, how much would withstand the fire? I don't know. I know Daniel chapter 12 is one of the verses that motivates me. Turn to that one. Daniel chapter 12. And we'll have Q&A time here. Sorry about that going over. Daniel chapter 12, verse number 2. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. And they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. How many people have you turned to righteousness? If it's nobody, well, get to work, soldier. There's a job to be done. Quit worrying about the stupid bowl and who runs around the cow pasture with the football and start winning somebody to Jesus, okay? We get distracted with the dumbest things. What have you done for the Lord with your life? If I can help in any way, we want to. If you want to get my videos, make all the copies you'd like. Copy them. Give them away to people. People will sit home and watch a video that you will never get to come to church. Especially if you say, hey, you want to watch this video? No. I'll give you $20 if you watch it. No. I'll give you $500. Okay. Okay, now that we've agreed you'll watch it, let's go back and renegotiate that price, okay? How about $10, okay? Or $5. Find something to do. You could be a video missionary. I don't know, but just I would ask that each of you just examine your heart. Say, God, what do you want me to do? What can I do for your kingdom? Lord, show me my job. Doesn't every kid growing up in every family have something to do, like, you know, take out the trash or sweep the sidewalk or feed the dog or something? That's part of being in the family. Y'all got a job to do. Okay, well, you're in God's family. What's the job he's got for you to do? I don't know. I'm busy doing what I think he's got me to do. You go figure out what he's got for you to do. But let's go. Let's all get busy and do something. I have heard, there's a rumor going around, that you have some heathen here in the Dallas area. Is that true? Yeah. Okay. Well, go find them and fix it. Okay, go get them. All right, let's pray. Take about a 10-minute break, and then we'll come back. Q&A time. You're going to line up at the mic so the guy can video both if you have a question. Any questions are fair game. We'll go till 6 o'clock with Q&A time, or later if you want. I've got nothing to do but drive to Florida tomorrow. And there's a whole lot more we have. This is kind of an oversimplification. Hopefully these paper we passed out will help you get kind of the big picture of the second coming of Christ, which really has two parts, the rapture and then the return to the Battle of Armageddon. Feel free to take all the pictures you want. If you got a cell phone, take pictures of the chart, or you can get the chart. Theodore, don't we have it up as an e-book kind of thing? I don't know what an e-book is, but I've been locked up a while. But but you can. I know the hardback book will be available here in the next week, so sorry about that. We didn't get them in time, but you can get it downloadable somehow. And then somebody, who was it, printed out the whole book, downloaded it, printed out the whole thing. You got it there? You didn't bring it today, okay. It probably cost you more to print it out the pages than it. No? Okay. Almost a ream of paper, yeah. There's a lot in there. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these people. Come spend their Saturday afternoon, Lord, learning about your word. I pray that they've learned things that'll change their lifestyle, if it needs be. Get them motivated to win souls. And Lord, help us each to find somebody we can witness to and talk about you. And Lord, there's many people that need to be turned to righteousness, so help us to get busy and do it so that we can be counted in your book as wise, as the ones who win souls. Lord, please, move in every heart now today. Get something done with these lives here in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, about a 15-minute break, brother. We'll start up again at 9:45. Okay. Thank you. If you didn't see the airplanes, kids, come on out. We'll make some more airplanes. Dismissed.